poem from Helga. She says, in letters between Schiller and the poet Goethe, Schiller actually says that the murderers do not reveal themselves because they feel guilty. Since they are such evil, evil killers, they don't feel guilt. They don't have conscience. They reveal themselves because of the earlier appearance of the Erinyes, because something totally sublime, something totally eerie has been established. And therefore they lose control, give the secret away, and they are immediately seized and thrown before a tribunal and tried. Now, the same thing in contemporary America. The issue is not that we are going to get people because of their sense of guilt to admit anything. We must be the Erinyes. And in that regard, we're going to move on. I don't think Ramsey Clark has arrived, am I correct? If he is not, let's go to Jason Ross. He's editor of 21st Century Science and Technology. So Jason, come on.
Oh, good, I'm glad to be here. I'm glad that everybody is attending this event. I'm going to take the opportunity to discuss the future that we need to create in memory of Kennedy, recalling that although we must fight against evil, we have to act and live for the good and for the beautiful. So the greatest move forward during the birth of the space era was, as has been said, Kennedy's ambitious and, at the time, seemingly impractical or even impossible mission of sending human beings to the moon and back before the decade was out. So I'd like to read his statement on this. This is from his September 12, 1962 speech at Rice University, where he said, "We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. Because that challenge is one we are willing to accept, one we are unwilling to postpone, and one which we intend to win." Now, as we know, that goal was met, and with tremendous success. Economists estimating the payback, the value of the Apollo mission, of the moon mission of Kennedy, calculated roughly that for every dollar invested in that project, the payback was $10. And the payback wasn't the same kind of dollars that were invested. You know, when you make an expensive movie, you try to make the money back by selling tickets. You spend money, you get money, and nothing was really created in the process. The money that was created from the Apollo project wasn't advertising revenue for putting advertisements on the moon. It was new technologies that fundamentally transformed our lives of humanity for the better. From medicine, to agriculture, to material sciences, to automation. It was a huge economic driver. Now, over the past couple of years, we've had another string of space successes, as Dennis and Jeff had both mentioned. The landing of our Curiosity on Mars, tremendous success. China's Chang'e 3 lander on the moon, and the U-2 rover going around on the moon. India's successful insertion into Mars orbit of its Mars orbital mission. China's recent Chang'e 5T1 mission, which, I don't know if people even know this occurred, China sent a satellite to the moon and back, and a re-entry capsule landed on the Earth and was recovered. Did people even know that that happened?
No.
Wow. Okay, this is pretty incredible, right? So, these things are occurring. We had just a couple of weeks ago, ESA, the European Space Agency, their Rosetta mission, intercepted a comet. It took 10 years to get there because we haven't made the next step in rockets. It got there, orbited the comet. We actually landed something on a comet nucleus. This is astonishing. This is an amazing feat, an incredible success. And studying comets provides a unique insight into the past history of our solar system, because it's believed that the comets represent the state of things at the creation of our planetary system. Way to look back billions of years. We just did that. ESA did it. Humanity did it. So, I don't think I need to ask what the United States space program is looking like at present under the thrilling leadership of our recent presidents. But what I'd like to do is put this in context. I'd like to make an economic point and put it in a broader context. So, over the long term, the foundation of economic growth is, in a sense, like evolution in the biosphere. The move of life from the oceans onto land required new technologies. It required seeds, which developed that way. It required new types of reproduction, internal reproduction. For example, the way fish reproduce is they just squirt gametes in the water, they come together. On land, we're not in water, we have to do it a bit differently. Warm-bloodedness, this is a technology. So these kinds of big shifts in biology, those are the kinds of things to really focus on in economics, not making money. Although, if you're making economic growth, yeah, you'll make money. Maybe not as fast as a Wall Street gambler, but you will see it in that sense too. So, to look at this, let's look at this from the perspective of Vladimir Vernadsky. That name might be unfamiliar to you. He is, you probably heard, however, the term the biosphere. Vernadsky was a Russian-Ukrainian scientist who developed the concepts of distinguishing between basic physics, the biosphere, the power of life on the planet, and the noosphere, the power of our thought. He said that human beings, the power of our minds, that is a physical force. You know, a physicist might study what effect does magnetism have on the world around us? What does gravity do? A geologist might say, how does sedimentation affect our rivers? Vernadsky said, well, if you really want to study those things, you also have to ask, how does the human mind affect those things? How does the changing behavior of the human species affect the planet? He said, if you want to be a real geologist, you end up having to look at humanity. So let's look at a few of these major steps to look at where we need to go today and what it would mean to keep pursuing the kinds of new frontiers that Kennedy envisioned for us. The first technology that distinguished us from the animals was fire. Animals don't use fire. Many animals don't like fire. A domesticated dog might enjoy curling up near a fire, but wild animals don't create bonfires and then bring their meat to it to get cooked. Fire, think of the Greek story of Prometheus. According to this tale, Prometheus, an immortal, stole fire from Zeus in heaven and gave it to mankind as a gift. Zeus, the sort of archetypical dictator, said that humanity was not going to have fire. That was for him. And people were basically to be like slaves or like animals. Prometheus took that fire and created the human species. So think of what we do with that. With it, we are no longer a biological species. Right? What characterizes us as living beings is no longer our bodies. It's our minds. We have bodies, but you would be a very poor student of the human species if you looked at our bodies, the way of understanding us. You'd be missing almost everything. So let's look at the next technology that was developed. With fire from charcoal, we created the Bronze Age. This rock on the left you see here, this green rock, is called malachite. As a rock, it's very rocky. Looks like it's green. But other than that, it's a rock. There's nothing that special about it besides its color. But as we'll see in the next picture, this is using an acetylene torch, it's cheating. But originally using charcoal, which is created from wood by burning it slowly without much air, you can create a hotter chemical fire. It's able to transform malachite, as we see here, into what we recognize as copper. You add some tin to that, you have bronze. Now, bronze doesn't exist on Earth, except when human beings make it. So if you're a geologist and you're saying, where does this bronze come from? It can only come from human beings. We're creating states of nature that never existed before, a material that never existed before. This was followed by the Iron Age. Now, if you really jump ahead, then quite some time, through the Renaissance, through the creation of modern science with Johannes Kepler, and the start of modern chemistry, which was only about 200 years ago, we had a crisis. Wood was being used so rapidly to make charcoal that we were running out of forests. Now, the extent of forests today in the eastern United States is actually greater than it was, at least in Pennsylvania and some other states, 150 years ago. In Europe, the forests were being decimated and the first environmental regulations were being passed to save the woods from charcoal makers. The technology that saved the forests is called coal. Right? Now, with coal, you don't need to chop down trees. With coal, you can create the steam engine. You can create power for motion, where we're able to use chemical energy to do work that we would have had to do with our muscles, or animals, or hope that the wind was blowing. The development then of electricity meant that we could transmit power through thin bits of metal, through wires, instead of carrying around coal and setting up a steam engine in every individual factory. If you look at this chart of electrical usage in the world today, on the bottom axis, you have the amount of electricity use measured in watts per person. This doesn't include all countries. We're off the chart on this one, for example, literally. And then on the vertical axis, you've got GDP. Now, leaving the lights on at night won't make you richer. But what this chart shows you is if you're a country without electricity, if you're a society without electricity, you're poor, period. There's no amount of alternative technologies is going to change that. This is an essential need for modern society. To jump ahead again, to nuclear processes. So already with one more thing to say about the chemical processes, with the use of coal to create power. Think about water. We use water for power. When water is used in hydroelectricity, some water just flows through a pipe and spins a wheel. Its weight creates power by falling through the chute. Water is made of hydrogen and oxygen. If instead of taking that water and putting it down through that chute, if you had used the oxygen in it to burn wood, if the hydrogen in it were somehow separated and you were burning it, you get a million times more power out of it, chemically, than when it's just a weight. With nuclear processes, we have a million times more power than chemistry. So uranium, for example, you can burn it if you want to. You can set it on fire. You could burn uranium in your stove to keep your house warm. If you use uranium in a nuclear power plant, you get a million times more power out of it. So compare it to the physical world, compare it to the beginning of this process. The nuclear world is a trillion times more powerful. Now, if you're looking at things like getting a return of 10%, consider the idea of getting a return of a trillion, right? 100 trillion percent return. These are the kinds of increases that have really made human society. So let's look in the next chart at how this has played out in the United States. This is an image of the use of power per person over the history of the United States. Two trends. It gets bigger. We're using more energy per person now. Secondly, the kind of power has changed. We don't use a lot of wood anymore. We use wood to build things with, but very few people are burning it for heat. Even fewer people are using wood to make charcoal to produce metal for, you know, a metal factory. Forget it, coal replaced it. In a large degree, oil and natural gas somewhat supplanted coal. Nuclear is that tiny red sliver there. So, what happened? Since the assassination of Kennedy, this power curve hasn't gone up. Since the assassination of Kennedy, we didn't see the development of that new energy resource. Efficient. We stop. Take our infrastructure. Another chart might be speeds of transportation. You can't really get places in the U.S. much faster now than you could 50 years ago. Amtrak hasn't gotten any faster. Excella does not count, really. And airplanes don't go any faster. So something stopped. Something happened. What I want to talk about now is the next level that we would need to go to. So, this picture may or may not mean something, but nuclear fusion would be the remaining step to make in the nuclear economy that Kennedy was intent on creating. I mean, he had a program for nuclear-powered rockets as well. With nuclear fusion, instead of splitting apart atoms, we put them together, we get 10 times more power out of it, and for reasons that I'm not going to get into here, we're able to create power directly without creating heat. With fusion power, using helium-3, we can create electricity and power directly without using heat to boil water and spin a fan, which is how nuclear power plants today work and how the ones being planned around the world for fusion would work. Getting things hot and spinning a fan. With fusion, we don't have to do that anymore. Now, how are we going to do this? There's one problem. Helium-3 is not here on Earth. Helium-3 is on the moon. Let's see what the Chinese have to say about that. Here's Ouyang Ziwan, or a man whose name sounds like that. He's the father of the Chinese lunar program. And he says, helium-3, an isotope of the element helium, is an ideal tool for nuclear fusion power, the next generation of nuclear power. It is estimated that reserves of helium-3 across the Earth amount to just 15 tons, while 100 tons of helium-3 will be needed each year if nuclear fusion technology is applied to meet global energy demands. The moon, on the other hand, has reserves estimated at between 1 and 5 million tons. From that energy chart I showed before, Kennedy's administration estimated that we would have twice the power available per capita than we do today. The world as a whole uses only about 20% the power per capita of the United States. Put all this together, and you're talking about an order of magnitude increase of power required for the world to be at a state that Kennedy thought we would already be at today. There is no way to provide this amount of power to lift the world out of poverty with solar panels, certainly, with windmills, with natural gas, or frankly, even with coal. The only potential source for this quantity of power requires that we move on to that next level, that we do what we have not done yet, that we implement nuclear, that we develop the research to get fusion working, and that we use that unique power of the fusion fuel on the moon, helium-3, to create the, you know, two generations beyond now in terms of this. This might seem strange, eccentric, unnecessary. Why haven't I heard about this? It might seem as strange as Kennedy saying that we should go to the moon and bring people to the moon and back within a decade. China's not waiting for us to make up our mind to do it. They're doing it. Right? We discuss these other space initiatives, or other initiatives of the BRICS, you know, that Jeff had mentioned. You know, China's got this space program. They're building thousands and thousands of kilometers of high-speed rail. They're financing a new Silk Road. They're developing the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank and the New Development Bank. India. Prime Minister Modi of India is moving ahead with plans to get every Indian access to a toilet. This is a country where a large percentage of people still practice open defecation. Prime Minister is saying we're actually going to fix that quickly. He says we're going to build 100 new cities. He plans to make 1 million jobs a year in India. In BRICS, there is significant growth. Jeff mentioned also Egypt, the development of the Suez Canal at a rate that surprises Americans, that it seems impossible they could have got the financing together to do it, and that they're just building it. They're building a new Suez Canal. They're not waiting, they're just doing it. So overall, this is an American tradition of economics, of recognizing that growth and development can't be measured by money, but is measured in terms of increasing the power of the human species over nature and developing our ability to increase our numbers and to increase living standards physically, not monetarily. Let me read two quotes from two presidents here, one from the president of China and one from a president of the United States. Here's President Xi Jinping. He says, the Pacific Ocean is broad enough to accommodate the development of both China and the United States, and our two countries to work together to contribute to security in Asia. These are mutually complementary efforts instead of mutually exclusive ones. I also introduced to President Obama China's initiatives of establishing the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank and the Silk Road Fund. Underdeveloped infrastructure is the main bottleneck obstructing the economic development of Asia. China has initiated the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank in order to offer support and facility to regional infrastructure development. These proposals and initiatives are open and inclusive in Asia. They are not exclusive. We welcome the active participation of the United States and other relevant countries so that together we can promote and share prosperity and peace in the Asia Pacific. China is ready to work with the United States to make efforts in a number of priority areas and putting into effect such principles as non-confrontation, non-conflict, mutual respect, and win-win cooperation. And with unwavering spirit and unremitting efforts, we will promote new progress in building a new type of model of major country relations between the two countries, so as to bring greater benefits to our two peoples and two countries. So that was from President Xi Jinping in China, inviting the United States to join in the projects that China is launching. China is not trying to create an empire. China is, believe it or not, they're doing what they're saying. They're looking for opportunities, as he says, of win-win cooperation, developing infrastructure, overcoming bottlenecks, and developing the economies. Here's President Kennedy. He said, we seek not the worldwide victory of one nation or a system, but a worldwide victory of man. The modern globe is too small, its weapons too destructive, and its disorder is too contagious to permit any other kind of victory. Global security is a global matter. You can't have local security and chaos elsewhere. The policy being pursued by the United States right now is incredibly dangerous in this regard. Increasingly, the world is turning towards this other direction, that of the BRICS, which is historically the outlook of the United States. Now, we've come to a point where it's not enough for us to think about being American, where our reservoir of being able to look back to examples from our past and always find something that's good enough to move us forward. That might not work at this time. We might have to think self-consciously about what our role as a nation will be and what our role as people will be. You know, I was talking to Dennis a few days ago who had looked at part of the tragedy of the Kennedy assassination was not only that Kennedy was assassinated, but who was there to take his place. That Lincoln was almost assassinated before he even got into the White House. It was not a surprise. I mean, it's a tragedy that Lincoln was killed, but it wasn't something that he couldn't have ever imagined would occur to him. Of course he knew that was a risk. Who was there to replace him? So if we operate having, on occasion, a great leader who's able to do great things for us, and we aren't developing that sense of commitment to history and to development ourselves, is it possible to exist as a democracy with that? I'd ask that question. And I'd like to conclude by saying something about the role of science in all of this. Not only is science, and culture as well, but not only is science the basis of economy, the reason that we have economies and animals don't, the reason that we change from generation to generation, and beavers, they build dams, but they haven't introduced rebar, they haven't developed any new technologies, right? Animals don't develop willfully from generation to generation. We do, and that is the most fundamental aspect of the human experience. Discovery. Finding out new things. Doing something tomorrow that was impossible today. And while we have had a tradition, you might say, of breaking traditions in the United States, a tradition of developing new types of economic outlooks, of developing new technologies, the tradition of being a creative discoverer is something that has to imbue culture and provides the best possible basis for cooperation with other nations on what makes us human and what we hold most in common, our ability to make these developments, to share them with others, and improve our well-being by doing that. Thanks.